هيا على الفلاح.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الرحمن علم القرآن خلق الإنسان علمه البيان. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. فالحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. ثم ما بعد. Once again everyone, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Let's try and get to know سورة الرحمن, a very famous surah of the Quran, one of the most beautiful surahs in the Quran. It has quite a bit of repetition, so let's talk about that first. One of its unique salient features is the repetition of the phrase فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان. Then what of the favors, wonders, gifts of the master of both of you, both of you are referenced to human beings and to jinn, are you going to be in denial of? Unique about the surah, first and foremost, you may have guessed that it addresses both human beings and the jinn. That's something uniquely that Allah does in the surah. And throughout the surah, everything is in pairs. Just like the human being, a pair of species are being talked to, jannas are in pairs. He talks about them twice. He talks about gardens twice. Across the board, there's this theme of pairs moving along. The thing about the repetition, the first thing I'd like you to note is that repetition is done for certain purposes. It's not just for style or for emphasis, but it has a greater rhetorical and communicative purpose. And that purpose is actually the expression of anger. How much more ungrateful can you be? How much more ungrateful can you be? How much more ungrateful can you be? It's this progression of Allah's anger towards people who just completely reject the idea of gratitude, who don't look around them and feel any need, any compulsion to want to be thankful for what they've been given. And that's how the ayat progressed. But then that same exact phrase, as you get to the part where the latter half of the surah, where Allah starts talking about heaven and the people of heaven, He gives them a gift and says, how many favors would you deny? And he imposes His favor on those that he's benefited, not just in this world, but in the next also. And so as that same phrase gets more and more and more intense and builds up in its intensity in the first half of the surah, it actually starts declining and getting softer and more loving, an expression of Allah's love in the latter half of the surah. And that's part of the beautiful tone and texture of the surah, Surah Ar-Rahman. Now, about the subject matter of the surah, it's interesting that it's broken up into about five passages. You can say that there are five distinct subject matter in the surah. And the first of them, of course, is Allah's grand gift of the teaching of the Qur'an. Ar-Rahmanu 'allama al-Qur'an. That's the first core subject matter, and how the Qur'an is catered to the nature of human beings and how it resonates with their inner selves, and how that's an expression of Allah's love, care, and mercy. And that's why it's predicated by Ar-Rahmanu 'allama al-Qur'an, not Al-Alim Mu'allam al-Qur'an, the one who knows everything taught the Qur'an. No, the one who is exceedingly and unimaginably loving and merciful and caring is the one who taught the Qur'an. So Allah's act of teaching the Qur'an is an act of His love, care, and mercy. That's the first passage. Beyond that, He says, well, for the people who don't appreciate the marvel of this book, they tend to be the same people that don't appreciate the marvel in anything. They don't appreciate the marvel all around them. So He starts pointing out things all around us, like the creation of the sun and the moon, الشمس والقمر بحسبان والنجم والشجر, the star, the tree. And these are particularly to the Arab taste, because the Arabs didn't have much of a landscape, but at night they could appreciate a sky full of stars. And in the daytime, one rare tree they'll find out in the desert landscape, and it's a symbol of beauty to them. So He calls on the things that they look upon as symbols of beauty. And for pondering and for appreciation, He starts talking about the oceans and the pearls that come out of the oceans, how the ships sail in the sea, and all of the. And then He says how all human beings are dependent on Him. So these worldly gifts of Allah are the second. So the first was the heavenly gift of Allah, which is the revelation. The second passage are the worldly gifts that people are in denial of, that are all around them that they should ponder upon. The third passage of the surah is actually about Judgment Day. And He basically gathers both human beings and jinns. سَنَفْرُغُ لَكُمْ أَيُّهَا الثَّقَلَانِ. Two large, heavy gatherings, heavy communities. And He gathers them together, and Judgment Day has begun. The sky is starting to rip. And, there's rocks falling and burnt copper and burnt metal falling onto the ground. The earth itself is tearing open. All of this cataclysm is happening, and that's being described. And the criminals are running, and they don't even have to be asked. You can tell from the look on their faces where they stand. And then the questioning begins. And as a result of the questioning, they're now starting to, the worst of the criminals are being chucked into hellfire. A very horrific, graphic scene in the surah, which begs the question for a lot of people, how can the surah begin with Ar-Rahman, the exceedingly loving, caring, merciful, and then have such a graphic description of hell right in the middle of the surah, right in the heart of the surah? Why would that be the case? This is actually part of Allah describing His mercy. Why? Because whether you like it or not, hellfire exists. And it's better for you to hear about it and be horrified by its description in word rather than having to see it. You know, this is Allah actually giving us the gift of that. The people before us, the people who were given revelation before us, they have lost the idea that hell is a scary place. They make mockery of it. Some of them have even erased all mention of it from their revelations. For Muslims, hell is never a joke because Allah doesn't let it be. It's too serious of a thing. And that's a gift of Allah to us. Imagine a danger is coming and people are taking it as a joke, right? Then they're not ready to deal with it, nor are they in any position to protect themselves, take proper precaution, to be able to arm themselves against it. That's the gift of Allah to those who He terrifies them out of their wits in this surah. And once He terrifies them, now begins the discussion of paradise. But the way it begins is so beautiful. وَلِمَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ جَنَّتَانَ Whoever was scared of standing before his master gets two gardens. In other words, first He scares you, then He says, if you got scared, you get heaven. Subhanallah. It's so beautiful that even when he scares you for a larger, greater purpose. And that's to grant you Jannah. May Allah make all of us people of Jannah. Now, what happens interestingly in this surah is Jannah is talked about spread over two passages. So I start, the first passage was about the grandeur of revelation. The second was the grandeur of the gifts of Allah, the earthly gifts of Allah. The third was the consequences of those who are in denial of both of those things, judgment day and eventually hellfire. And then for those who got scared of that warning, they get two gardens. Those gardens start getting described with beautiful fruits and spouses and housing and waterfalls and all of it. And then وَمِن دُونِهِمَا besides them, there are two other gardens and another two set of gardens get described, which is peculiar. You know, you got these two, why not just give one description of gardens? Why break them up into two? You know, and then describe them all over again as lusciously green, with overflowing waterfalls, with, you know, fruits like, pomegranate and dates, nakhlun wa rumman, you know, and then once again, the mention of beautiful spouses and sitting on couches, rafrafin khudrin wa abqariyin hisan, and all kinds of exotic, you know, items that are sitting all around them, like imported goods, you know, and decoration pieces in their housing. That's the description of this second heaven. And if you'll appreciate this organization of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, Quran, worldly gifts, you know, judgment and hell, heaven one and heaven two. You can talk about it like that. These five subjects, when you understand the placement of this amazing surah, the surah that is coming right after this is Waqi'ah. And Surah Al-Waqi'ah actually discusses these five concepts in reverse order. The last thing talked about in Surah Al-Waqi'ah, one of the last passages, فَلَا أُقْسِمُ بِمَوَاقِعِ النُّجُومِ وَإِنَّهُ لَقَسَمٌ لَوْ تَعْلَمُونَ عَظِيمٌ إِنَّهُ لَقُرْآنٌ كَرِيمٌ The greatness of the Qur'an is at the end of Surah Al-Waqi'ah. If you work back, and this was the first subject here, as you work backwards in Surah Al-Waqi'ah, Allah says, أَنْتُمْ أَنْشَأْتُمْ شَجَرَتَهَا أَمْ نَحْنُ الْمُنْشِئُونَ أَنْتُمْ أَنْزَلْتُمُوهُ مِنَ الْمُزْنِ أَمْ نَحْنُ الْمُنْزِلُونَ You know, Allah asks, are you the one growing the crop? Are you the one creating the fire? Are you the one that, you know, produces the rain, et cetera, et cetera? Like, He keeps asking these questions as if Allah is the one who does them. He asks the question, do you? Which is exactly the same. The second last is exactly the same as the second subject here, the worldly gifts of Allah, put in the form of a question. Then on the third subject there, interestingly enough, is the people of the left hand. This is an expression in the Quran for people who are given their book of deeds in their left hand, which means that they're in trouble, basically, on Judgment Day. And if you notice, the third middle subject here in Surah Ar-Rahman was actually also hellfire. So the people who receive the book in their left hand are terribly judged, and they're given the worst sentences, you know? And then in the beginning of Surah Al-Waqi'ah, you've got two groups of people, as-sabiqun and ashabul yameen, the first and the foremost, and the people of the right hand. There are two groups of people. First and the foremost, the highest ranking of the believers, who were the first to step into the faith, regardless of the consequences, and made the greatest of sacrifices. But they're not the only ones, the great heroes of the faith. There are also those who happen to be good people, anybody who gets the record in their right hand. So there are two levels of good people. And interestingly enough, we just saw in Surah Ar-Rahman, there were two different levels of Jannah being described, two different categories of heavens being described. This is just part of the coherence and how the Quran just syncs together. how things tie together in this remarkable, remarkable book. Surah Al-Rahman is a very easy surah to memorize, especially if you understand the order and the subject matter. Inshallah, it should be no problem for you to memorize it and ponder over its meanings. Barakallahu li wa lakum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. If you enjoyed this video, please do share it with friends and family. If you want to see more videos from this series, click on the box at the top. If you want to see other videos, click on the box at the bottom. And don't forget to hit the subscribe button. Thanks.